Thank you, everyone, and welcome. We're here tonight for a forum on recycling, and the town has taken a concerted effort in trying to reduce our contamination in our recycling, and we have a panel of people here tonight to answer questions and are very knowledgeable in the recycling field with the recycling program that we instituted as well this past year. So let's introductions. We'll go forth and introduce yourself, what you did for the town, and your role.
Sure. So my name is Amanda Lansing. I was the recycling enforcement supervisor for the recycling IQ program that we did. So that was a team of four of us that went out and did the recycling inspections across the town for a period of 8 weeks to try to sort of educate people on what should and should not be going in their bins and ultimately try to reduce the contamination that was in the stream.
Wonderful. I'm Irene Congdon. I'm the regional recycling coordinator with Central Massachusetts with Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection. And I'm helping get the town, work with the town on the grant for the IQ program. And we have various grants, and that's one of them. And the other is funding for education enforcement. So, and lots of support for recycling correctly. And we'll talk more about that at the Recycle Smart program as well.
Hello, and I'm Tessa David. I'm the director of the Mass Toss Cooperative and the Devens Regional Household Hazardous Waste Collection Center. So we work with a number of aspects of whether it be everything from contracts to what reporting goes into the state to how we can see how we reduce our save our resources.
Hi, I'm Paul Dagnan. I'm with Casella Recycling. I'm the general manager of the material recovery facility, or most people call it MRF, in Auburn, Mass. I handle most of the recycling from central Massachusetts communities. We really appreciate, and we've worked with the town and the DEP and TOSS on trying to clean up the material that comes into the MRF. It's a huge assistance to us to remove contamination from the stream, remove bags. Anything that can go into the recycling that doesn't belong can cause a lot of issues for us, safety issues, quality issues. And so whatever we can do to improve that, we stand behind.
So why don't we start off by talking about big change in the recycling industry with China's national sewer policy. And maybe, Paul, if you can start off from Casella's standpoint and what that brought about in the industry.
Sure. So Casella Recycling, Casella Waste Systems, is really a company that's focused in the northeast of the United States. We are a publicly traded company. We have about eight different large recycling facilities that take in residential recycling, do an awful lot of sorting, and ultimately, once it gets sorted, it's packaged in bales, and those bales get sent to mills to actually get made into a new product. And for the last 20 years or so, that market for the purchase of the bales to be made into something new has really been overseas, and the big buyer has been China. And a couple of years ago, China was concerned about some of the quality of the material that they were receiving, and also wanted to kind of bolster their own recycling infrastructure within the country. So they started to push back, set higher quality standards, and then actually stopped accepting many different grades of recyclables. One of the biggest grades is mixed paper. So mixed paper is a combination of newspaper, junk mail, cereal boxes, and cardboard. And it makes up probably 35% of the recycling stream, and China stopped purchasing that completely. These are commodity markets that really work on supply and demand, and when the largest buyer, who buys 3/4 of the material in the world, drops out of the market, all of that material has to go someplace else or not go anyplace at all. And it's had a huge effect on the value of material. But then it's also caused other overseas markets and domestic mills to look at the quality of the paper that they receive and the pricing around it. So what it's basically caused is a huge crash in commodity prices, not only for mixed paper, but it also trickled over to cardboard and newspaper and plastics as well. You know, 5 years ago, we looked at the overall value of a ton of single stream after it was sorted. You know, it was somewhere to around $70 or $80 a ton value after we processed it. Now it's closer to $10 a ton. So there's been a huge reduction. Just to give you a quick update, just recently, generation period, right, around Christmas, a lot of people generating product. A lot more mixed paper gets generated around the holidays. And meanwhile, India has stopped buying. So every producer of mixed paper in the Northeast is sitting on bales that they can't move. They're just not buyers of material. And I know of some other facilities, not ours, we're sitting on about 20 loads. I know people who are sitting on hundreds of loads of material right now that they can't sell. And I just made a deal for 5 loads to go out at $45 a ton charge.
That's mixed loads and not cardboard, right?
That's mixed paper. Yep.
And then you have to pay to get rid of it.
Mixed paper, we're paying $45 a ton to get rid of it. Right. So that's where the market, we're very concerned about the markets.
No, but they fluctuate.
So, okay, I've got the floor, I'm sorry. So, so one of the things that people have said for a long time is that the recycling industry fluctuates and it's a cyclical market. That overall concept really has gone away. We don't see the markets coming back to where they were 5 years ago anywhere soon, like 10 years. The market is not going to come back. And we need to stop talking that it is going to come back. We need to be prepared for tough markets. Will they stay this tough? You know, we hope not, but they're not going to get a whole lot better. The mill in Maine, for example, that was supposed to take mixed paper at the end of this year, has decided to not do that. They're going to take cardboard.
They're only going to take cardboard.
Yeah. So that market's changing.
So,
yeah, it's a frustrating dynamic, it's a frustrating industry when people kind of have this concept that when things are recycled, there's a value. The key to recycling, and people absolutely should continue to recycle, but the key is that it saves those resources from just being put into a hole in the ground or burned. Right? We need to. We're not a wasteful society. We can't just throw things away and make new things. We need to try to try to conserve those resources. Thanks.
Are there any questions?
So actually, we have a couple things we have to do. And so one of my roles is I turned around and got certification from the state to be a waste ban inspector. I wasn't wearing these nice boots. I have to wear my muck boots. So, you know, your horse stall boots, those work when you're taking a look at what all is coming on down the line and being dropped up over back to Stella. We have to go there and take a look at it and see what all it is and see what there is and what's acceptable and what will the markets take for us. So that's one of the things that we've taking a better look at and see how can we improve that. And now Amanda's done quite a bit of that to help them further enforce what all is it that we can collect, because so many of us want to recycle. We want to have a home for these things. But as Paul was saying, all those homes that we used to have aren't necessarily there. We're hoping that domestically we'll get those markets back, but it will take time, right? The infrastructure has to be set up. We basically shut down several. We had some mills in Fitchburg. We had mills all around here locally that were driven away because China got such a cheap ride on the material. We take in so many things and empty vessels going back. we just kind of threw it on there. They were paying big bucks, competing much more for against our labor, and so those businesses dissolved. But now we have the incentive, and hopefully that's a good thing. More jobs for us, more industry here, but it takes time, right? So with that's one thing we're hoping that will be a good fringe. Right now it doesn't feel good because it hurts because we don't have a place to take it, but we hope that builds up our market. And then at the same time, we have to look at what are we collecting? Is it really recyclable? Because that's what China was saying. You're sending us a lot of garbage in with your recycling. We can't make paper out of glass. We can't make glass out of paper. Those two are mortal enemies. They need to be separate. We need to just make sure we have that, make sure that we don't have ropes. We can't do anything with these ropes. Our machines can't sort that out at the plants. We need more of the good stuff, and we need to do well with the large volumes of stuff, our containers, our food containers, and not worry about all the other things we think we might be able to recycle, because if we think we can, probably, maybe not. And it's probably an anomaly. It's probably not your large volume item, so don't worry about it. And it kind of drives you crazy too, right? Trying to figure out whether or not I can recycle. But do well with your basic things, large volume of containers, food containers, your paper, keep your textiles separate, put them in bins, put them in the bins around town that you have. And then if you come to other items that are not supposed to go in the trash, that's another hat I have. Do that one, I'm sure. So that one, and I won't put all this stuff on because I have a lot of other stuff that I have to wear for this one here. But, you know, you worry about that stuff with your, you know, they've been talking about Monsanto and what all is going up there with the Roundups. What do I do with that? They're saying that's not really good. So, yikes, what am I going to do with that? I need to wear something to handle it appropriately. Well, luckily, you don't every day have this stuff, but periodically, maybe a month or every couple of months, you could take a ride over. Yeah, so, okay, here we go. Got my stuff. Handle all this stuff. See what you're gonna bring me. Here. We've got. Oh yeah, I have gloves too. I do have gloves. Oh, well, did you want a respirator too? I do have a respirator, but I'm not pouring it off now, so I don't need a respirator now. But I do need this for the gloves. So you've got all these things that can't go into your trash recycling. 20 times a year, the first Wednesday and following Saturday of the month from March until December, you can take it to the Devon's Regional Household Hazardous Waste Collection Center. So you round up. Now you don't have to worry about that. You don't have to worry about it spilling and your kids or pets getting into it. Your garage, your oils, your waste oils and whatnot. That bleach you're never going to use. I've kept it forever. It's like, oh my gosh, this store isn't even in marketing business anymore. But little bit left, I've had it, I'm not using it, it's not good for my septic system, for my septic field. But you may want to use a little bit, share it with your neighbors, ask your neighbors first, can you use this little bit? And if you can't, then okay, I'll have to take it to this place, but if you can find it. But you know, your furniture polishers, your thinners, your, you know, some of those bugs we just can't stand. Most of them you can preventatively, but sometimes termites, this is something I like to get something for that. Cleaning your TSP for your walls, all these various things, 20 times a year you can take care of those items there and take that there. The key is touch base. If you don't know, ask about it. Or and there is a home. There is a home and a proper handling of those materials. And we're happy to talk and we're glad you're here to ask. Thank you.
Wow. All right, Irene, you have that.
I have the money. So I give you the grant money for the towns, the grant money for the hazardous waste facility, the grant money to the facilities to update their equipment so that they can take more paper and able to densify their bales. So you don't have as many around, so they can get more squished. So on a state level, we're very supportive of waste reduction. That is our theme. We're right now in the midst of the 20 to 2030 waistband plan. And that, like the past 10 years and beyond before that, was continuing to waste. We have to work on our waste reduction. We need to get the materials that are hazardous out of our trash. They don't belong in our landfills. They don't belong in our incinerated waste energy facilities. They do not belong in any of our recycling bins. If things get emptied, you know, old detergent bottles can go in your recycling bin. But we don't want the oil containers in your recycling. We have a campaign that has been put together. It's our first time. I know it's about a year and a half old. Is recyclesmartma.org. So I know you guys
are a member.
And you are a member, and you've gotten all the information. And of course, you're going to talk more and more about all the wonderful things that you guys have on it. The Recycle Smart logo. It has the Facebook page. It has all the resources on there. We have worked with all the different MRFs, material recovery facilities, to have what can go in there, because everybody has their list. Is it a yes? Is it a no? I got this. It's a little different. It was before, but now it has a new cap on it. Is it? We have it all listed out to say yes or no. We have over 500 items listed in there, so you can say cups, and then it'll tell you if it's a ceramic cup. No, it's trash. You know, reuse it, give it to a charity. Is it a styrofoam cup? It's trash. If it's a plastic cup, it has a question. If it's a clear plastic cup and it's rinsed, it can be recycled. But it goes through all those details. So if you want to dive deep, you can dive deep on recyclesmartma.org and go to the town website and go to that link. But if you want the basic, we have all the basic. I mean, it's just the basic of cans, bottles, plastic jars, jugs, and tubs. It's a little different when I say it's things that have lids on it. Your packaging that had lids on it.
And that's the recyclopedia.
Absolutely. The recyclopedia is very supportive of that. And then I help with, the recycling. We're doing a lot of reuse of getting people before you throw something out. It's also when you're buying stuff to think ahead of schedule. Do I really need this? And we're doing more yard sales. I mean, you guys have... Lunenburg has a great community yard sale that happened in spring and summer. So there's other ways to think about your stuff besides just disposing of it, trying to find people that can reuse it, such as old chemicals and things like that. Hey, let's find somebody that can reuse it before we dispose of it. So that's what we're
at. And so how has the industry affected Lunenburg? You started doing a lot more education, outreach, and try to educate the public through flyers and ads in our local paper, putting the Recycle Smart messages on our town Facebook page, just sharing that information, updating our town website as well with all that information as well. But we made a huge effort this past year in applying for the Recycle IQ grant, which we received, and Amanda was a huge part of that and the success of that program. So I'll let Amanda talk about that and your experience, the feedback you got from residents, what type of questions, the most commonly typed items that people are questioning whether they belong in recycling.
Sure. Yeah. So. I love the Recycling IQ program. I think it's really wonderful. So the Recycling IQ program was basically designed to help educate people in the town on what should and should not be in their bins. And so we did that through an 8-week program. There was myself and a team of 3 other people, and we had specific routes to follow. And the idea was to actually physically get out there in the field and look at what people were putting into their bins. And so we did a week of just sort of putting stickers on people's bins to let them know that in the coming weeks, if they saw people in vests just out there going through their stuff, not to worry that we were there working for the town. The idea was to try to go through and dig through as much as we could to see what should and should not be in those bins. And I know the town sort of developed the thresholds that they felt were acceptable for, say, if somebody had plastic bags in their bins. You know, if we were going to reject that bin for pickup, would we do it for just one bag, or would we do it for three bags? And for some of those larger categories, like things like not washing out your food containers, and, you know, tanglers, cords, ropes. So the idea was to go out, and if we felt that the bins exceeded those thresholds, was to put a rejection sticker on it, and Casella would not pick it up. But it was also to try to explain to those homeowners why that bin was rejected. And so the stickers had items that we could circle, that we could say that shouldn't be in there, and then we would try to write notes if we felt like it needed a little bit more of an explanation as to why. And then if the next week, if that homeowner had cleaned out their bins appropriately, the bins were picked up, we took the sticker off without a problem. And the beginning of the program was a little rough. There was a lot of rejections, and it was obvious that people wanted to do the right thing, but they just didn't know that there were certain things that should not be in there. And that became more and more evident to me as we talked to people who were home and would come out and would ask us questions about why their bin was rejected. You know, a lot of people, I found with plastic bags especially, their first thought is, well, it has a recycling symbol on it, so can't I put it in my bin? Or things like certain pieces of styrofoam, well, it has a recycling symbol, can't I put it in my bin? And that, I think, was the biggest level of confusion for people, was, well, how am I supposed to know, because it has the recycling symbol on it and there's this number, but it can't go in my bin. And so trying to explain that there's, you know, for most items that works, but for very specific things, they can be recycled, but they have to be recycled a different way. Plastic bags, I know Heather had mentioned, was one of the big contaminants in the town before the program even started. I can say, if I look at the data from the beginning to the end of the program, that definitely went down significantly once we explained to people, it's absolutely recyclable, this is what it can be turned into, you just have to take it back to the grocery store. You know, save them up, next time you go to the grocery store, bring them and put them in. One of the other big ones was styrofoam, and there seemed to be quite a bit of confusion between what was available online, maybe what somebody's neighbor said, oh, well, I was told this, and then somebody else said, oh, I was told, you know, I was told this, and really getting the message out there that right now styrofoam should just be put in the trash and cannot be, you know, cannot be recycled. Those were two of the, plastic bags and styrofoams were two of the biggest ones. I know you had mentioned before shredded paper and how we're trying to find a home for that, because that was another huge thing for people. You know, they don't want to put their personal documents that are just on computer paper into their recycling bin. So they said, oh, I'll shred it and I'll put it in. And there was conflicting messages about, no, you can't recycle it. Yes, you can, as long as it's in a paper bag. Yes, you can, as long as it's in a plastic bag. You know, so I spoke with several different people who all kind of got different answers about that. So I think there was a little confusion with communication because so many people were involved, but for the most part I found that people were very receptive to the program, and when we actually stopped to talk to people face to face, they appreciated the information. A lot of people were surprised, I think, when we would say, you can't put this in. All in all, we definitely had a pretty significant reduction in contamination in the town, which is great. So I think it was a success. You know, I think it's really important though to keep those messages going. And I'm hoping that once the program stopped, I'm hoping that the loads that have continued to go back to Casella have had decreased contamination. But I think it's a really wonderful program, and The Recycle Smart website is phenomenal. I use it myself for everything. I used it in the field if there was anything in a bin that we really just weren't sure about. It was a great resource to have. And it's actually surprising how much information that you've gotten on there. So,
another product of the whole project was that we were able to update our website appropriately as well with these types of questions, with those items.
Yes.
To make sure there was even more information on there so people would have another resource or place to refer to for the correct information. So, yeah, we started off our audit of our materials in December of 2018, was about 20% contaminated. And our last audit at the end of the program was 6.4%. So,
I have a question for you, Amanda. When you were talking about trash paper, it wasn't clear in your description whether people can recycle shredded paper or not.
So I'm going to refer that to one of you guys because I never actually got a clear answer on that.
Because we have it's a messy. It just goes flying around. Maybe you can share.
I mean, I can kind of share real world. I mean, I think what we always try to defer to, though, is the Recycle Smart list, because it's something common across the entire state, right? So we only handle a certain portion of that, and people move around, right? So if shredded paper comes into our facility, the way the facility works is one of the first stages in the process is to try to break glass and sort it by size. If shredded paper comes in loose or gets loose, it will go out with the glass and will contaminate the glass. We try to use an air system to try to clean up the glass, but it only does so much.
And what did I say about glass and paper? They're mortal enemies.
Yeah. It just doesn't make sense. And then if the paper gets wet at all, which it does in the process at times, it sticks to the glass. So it's definitely problematic in the process. And so we would err towards, I think the Recycle Smart website says, to not put it in.
Okay.
I mean, the issue is, like, it's the question is with certain materials, is it recyclable or not? Shredded paper is recyclable, right?
Plastic, not in your system.
Exactly.
So.
And that's what we're trying to do, right? We're trying to solve that confusion by saying it's our system, just like anybody else's system, cannot capture 100% of what is ultimately recyclable.
Yeah, because metal is recyclable, but hangers are a problem. So you,
that's right.
In the situation that you're in, it can't be recycled in the process. No. The process denies it.
But we do have some regional opportunities. So for shredding paper, we have at least one event coming on soon. It will be in April, and I can give you the official date. It will be at the Townsend Town Common on... I go backwards here, just using paper. The 25th, April 25th at the Townsend Town Common. And we've been having that free service every year at Earth Day for people to bring their things. So right after you finish taxes, get all your boxes
first,
and stuff.
First that year, right?
And yeah. Instead of doing one bag or a couple papers at a time, just bring the box and the machine will do it for you and it's done for free and you can watch it there.
Oh, that's cool. So what date is the date of that?
April 25th. To 2020. And then we've been having in air, as in Shirley, we've been having it, and so right now it's 2021 is the proposed for in October. So that would be the next one. So the goal is to kind of have April and October, but we're taking a year off for the Recycle Your Reusable, unless somebody wants to step up to help organize. We need always need more volunteers to come and help.
Oh, that's a good idea.
I will. Thank you. And just one other thing I wanted to mention with the plastic bags was, one, loose plastic bags should not be in your bin, because the biggest thing, they get to the facility, they try to sort them, they get caught in the machines, and one, it's you know, it can cost a lot. They have to shut down the machines, and two, it's a safety hazard. They have to send somebody in there to cut them out sometimes. That's the same thing with ropes and cords and things. But a lot of what we saw, at least in like the first half of the project, was bagging of recyclables. And, you know, in Lunenburg, you can use whatever sort of plastic container you have for your recycling. And I think what a lot of people may do is fill up a bag in their house, and then when they go to take their trash and stuff out, they just put the bag out. So if you want to use a garbage bag or something in your house, that's fine, but when you put it out at the curb, it should be loose in a bin, because if it gets to the facility and it's tied up in a plastic bag, they can't just dump that and sort it. Someone has to rip that bag open, and so just, you want to make sure to keep everything loose in your bins.
Thank you.
A few years ago, I was able to take my styrofoam to a place in Leominster.
They went out of business.
They went out
of business.
They were among
them. But I mean, does...
Nobody else.
So there, I go to Palmer.
But the...
That's a distance. It's a real distance.
I mean, you're going to spend all the fossil fuels.
So you can get, there is recycling in Palmer?
Palmer, and so Gold Circuit.
Gold Circuit, yeah.
And
Gold Circuit.
In Palmer, and then there's in Framingham, but you have to pay, it's Framingham, Dingley Arrow, you pay per bag of your styrofoam.
And what's the name of the place in Framingham?
Dingley Arrow.
So I just did an event, kind of like what we had, the Recycle Reusable. So when we have the event in Shirley, then we kind of say styrofoam okay. And I just did an event in Grafton, and we said styrofoam okay. So there was a particular time frame where we just took those items just at that time. Okay. So we do not want it at the curb.
But
pretty much the guy from Palmer came to those events and took it away at that event.
But they don't take as much as the business that went out of business used to take
you name it.
Yes. So no, they only want packing material, like your TVs in, that your large electronics
come in.
No food, no cups, because they've been burned by
food
still being in there.
Right. Yeah.
But
it's nice to know there's something that's still going.
Yeah.
So, I mean, for events like that, how would somebody find out if you're doing an event that they can?
So we have a Beyond the Bin online. You can Google Beyond the Bin Massachusetts, and that is for items that are not there. Beyond the Bin, they are not at the curb. They are different places. So when we say, what do I do with a cork? You know, I have wine, and I have a real cork, and that there's value in that cork, but it does not make sense to collect it at the curbside. It does not really make sense for a regular drop-off to collect it all the time. But there are certain events that will take corks. You know, at the recycling center, I'm from Townsend as well. So the Townsend Recycling Center is open the first and third Saturday of the month, and it is open to everybody. Anybody can go there, non-residents and residents and businesses. You pay for the different items that have costs, and you can go online to see what they take. But we are not taking styrofoam at this time.
And it's just called the Townsend Recycling Center? Online,
hopefully eventually creating a position that would be an education position as part of a grant-funded position, maybe regionally with a couple other towns. So that's the point we're at. We will continue to try to educate the public on and get that information out.
Does Costello look at the bins and reject bins if there's incorrect materials in it at this point?
That's a good question.
Yeah.
Yes. Yep, so the driver is trained to kind of spot check the bins, and if he or she sees something in there that shouldn't be there, that's more than just one or two items, kind of what Amanda said. They're not going to leave it for one coat hanger or something, right? The threshold isn't that low, but if it's obviously contaminated, they will leave it.
And do they leave it with a sticker? Okay.
Yes.
Great. Thank you.
You got it.
So, coat hangers, right now, coat hangers are a big issue because everybody's cleaning out their closets. So note that
dry cleaning
places love your metal hangers. Mm-hmm. And Walmart likes all hangers. So sometimes you can just go to Walmart and bring them back your old hangers. They love all those. And I normally bring them back to the customer service desk.
And sometimes some thrift shops, I've asked people about it, some thrift shops will take them as well. So.
No, I guess I'll just kind of chime in because I maybe sounded a little doom and gloom earlier. I do want to stress that I appreciate the effort. Single stream recycling absolutely works. It's easier than separating out all these different commodities. Yes, there is a cost associated with it, but again, we can't just have this mindset of a wasteful society. We need to try to conserve resources and do whatever we can. There are some values, but there are absolute values in keeping it out of the landfills and incinerators, especially where, and one of the things that's probably near and dear here, is that landfill space is getting to be a premium, and some of the landfills in this area are going to be closing possibly in the next 4 or 5 years. And so the more you can redirect the waste and the recycling to the proper location, the better off you'll be for the long run. And so all of these efforts are really good now because they set up habits for the long run, and we appreciate it.
One thing I wanted to add was composting.
Yes.
You know, we sell compost bins in Lindbergh. That's a great way to keep things definitely. Out of the waste stream.
Heavy, it's heavy, and that's what smells.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Perfect.
So we've talked about this before, right? They teach you reduce, reuse, recycle. You know, it is in that order, there's a priority there, and even though I'm in the waste and recycling business, if you can reduce or reuse, it goes a lot further than actually even getting into the recycling bin. So whatever we can do to capture all of those different things goes a long way.
Both Heather and I went to Casella for one of the last audits, and we took some pictures and wanted to show what the loads were there. This was a sample load, I thought you might like to see. They take a sample load, this was a load, and on November 20th, then you've got a team there. Two guys are sorting through every single item that's in the recycling. They're putting it into containers as to items that are rejected, and all the other items are going to then go to recycling. So what we found are these are some items that weren't recyclable. The cardboard, because it was wax coated, and then you can see down in the bottom of that container, peanuts. Packing peanuts are not recyclable. So those, they can be reused. So anybody who ships or packs would be happy to have your peanuts. UPS, sometimes the postal, UPS, the packaging stores will take them. But anyway, those aren't acceptable. Plastic mailing envelopes, no. Multi-layers, there may be paper on the outside, but there's plastic on the inside, plastic bubbles. So that is not recyclable. Aseptic are your old juice containers that have a layer of paper and wax. Some milk cartons, you know, the ones that you pull and then pull out there, it looks like paper, but it's actually a waxy paper. Those aren't acceptable. We don't have a market here. Nationwide, there are some places that do recycle them, but we don't have locally a place to recycle those as well. So looking another little bit closer look at those same items that weren't recyclable. So relatively small, because we ended up at 6.4, so Lindbergh was doing an awesome job at that. And in fact, out of the 128 pounds that were not recyclable, 200 wasn't acceptable. So that was the report that was filled out, and then what the guy said was the best load they've seen.
Awesome.
Good job. So it's continuing to do better. Continuing to, if you have a question, if you're in doubt, look it up, recyclesmartma.org, or if you can can't go that far, you don't have access, it's not something large volume of, throw it out. If you're in doubt, throw that out. Thank you. Doing a good job. Continue.
Can I ask you a question? So the plastic mailing envelopes, so this was another one. The ones that, there was a lot that I found, you know, they're the ones from Amazon, the blue and white ones, that have the recycling symbol off on them and they say store drop off. Can those actually go in with plastic bags to a store?
Did it say number 2 or 4 in it?
I don't remember, but I saw them all over the place.
Really?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So that may be a new evolution.
They've got the recycle symbol all over the place, and they say store drop off on them, but
okay.
People were thinking, oh, cool, I can recycle it, and they were dropping it at the bins.
Because sometimes staples.
But see, that's a case of the wrong place.
Sure. Yes. Okay. Yep. No, I understand
but
that.
It will be really exciting.
But it seems like you could drop it off with your plastic bag.
It's sounding like it. Sometimes some manufacturers are looking at something that may be available somewhere else. You know, this Jeff Bezos is in Washington State, so maybe out there they have a system for it. But maybe. It is something that we can, that's a 2 or 4, and it is a
I can't remember.
Not at the curb.
But not at the curb.
Yep.
Yeah. Back to the grocery store.
Yeah, no, I understand that. And that's, we tried to pull them out when we saw them. But I was just curious because.
Let's look that up.
Beyond the mission.
Just kind of looking at that picture, and it just reminded me that we saw a lot of them, and we were like, oh, cool, it says that you can return it to the store.
What store?
But I wasn't sure.
Sometimes Staples has it or the
I didn't know if it, yeah, I assumed, it. I assumed that it meant where you can bring like your number 4 plastic bags and stuff. I can't remember if there was a number in the recycling.
It needs to have that. So that
I think there was, but I just know they're blue and white, you know, they're the ones that are about this size or a little bit bigger, and they're the blue and white ones that are very thin, like, packing material on them.
That's exciting.
Lots we saw them a lot. Yeah.
New item for Recyclopedia.
Yes.
It might already be on there.
Yeah. All right. Well, I want to thank our panel. Thank you for coming tonight and help educate our residents. And I appreciate what you do.
Happy to be here.
Thank you for asking. Yeah,